board running, David.
What are you doing?
Nothing.
Why not? I'm
trying to get on the Slice Radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's all right. You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.
You like music, you like weed, well, we gonna be good friends indeed. This is how much I like more than smoking trees. They'll make you dance the do-si-do and teach you how the chiba grow. Smoke a bowl on the 420 radio show. On Lifestyle Radio.
We are here. Hi. Hi, hey, how
this
are
is
you?
Cheech. Uh-oh. This is Chong.
Uh-oh. Cheech and Chong are playing.
How high are you?
I'm playing with a new computer, so we'll get there. So, hi, how are you? How high are you?
Are you talking to us?
Yes.
Oh. Hi, Al.
Hi.
Nice to see you, or talk to you.
Nice to talk to you too, Marcel. How are you?
I'm fine, you?
I'm fine. Thank you for asking.
Oh. Does this mean we're finally on air?
Yes, we are, sir. Yes, sir.
So for the last 30 minutes, we've been talking and we haven't been on air.
It's only 7 minutes after seven, bonehead.
feels like 30 minutes, and I'm tired.
Are you saying it's time for a nap, Marcel?
Yeah, isn't it time for a song break?
Somebody's drinking beer. It's made him tired.
No, the drive may be tired.
The drive. Well, yeah, the drive would make you tired. Yeah.
How long did it take you to get home?
An hour and 45 minutes.
45 minutes longer than it normally does.
Yeah. Tends to happen when you're
You guys got snow, eh?
We have a mountain that we have to drive over that has its own little weather pattern, and today it was about 3 inches of frozen ice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's not good.
No, everywhere else it was kind of raining and wet snow, but up there it was just nothing but pure hell, freezing rain.
Huh, we're about to get dumped on this week.
That's all right, you guys can have it. I mean, you guys don't have enough snow there yet.
No, I don't want to. Okay, there we go. I'm playing with the volumes and stuff. So, I put some stuff in our chat. And I hear a hissing in my head. There. Now the hissing's gone. I don't know. Somebody's hissing. Stop hissing, man.
Oh, sorry. It was my breathing. You want me to stop?
Are you breathing again?
Yeah, I tried not to breathe.
All right. No breathing for you.
Yeah. Thanks, Al.
You're welcome. I just wanted to instruct everybody that nobody is allowed to breathe during the show.
Inhaled cannabis cuts headache and migraine severity by nearly half. Ingested cannabis gets rid of your migraine or headache. I think I'd rather get rid of it than cut it in half. What's a half of migraine feel like?
Just one eye.
Oh, okay.
and a finger or two.
Do you get to pick what eye?
No, sir.
Yeah.
No.
Oh.
No. So, there's lots of stuff to talk about in the news this week. I just can't remember what. No, I'm kidding.
Hey, did you hear the cop?
The cops?
He got 10 years.
The one out there?
Yep.
Yep. Yep, I actually just saw that. Let's see if I can find it.
Don't be selling coke if you're a cop. Don't be selling. It should be given away.
Cocaine, the cocaine copper.
Yeah.
I wonder what his nickname's going to be.
He's going to be bitch because he's going to jail for 10 years. It was pretty good that his buddies threw him under the bus and became paid informants for it.
Really?
Yep.
Well, that sounds a little rude.
One got $200,000 and the other one got all of his legal fees covered.
Wow.
That was their payment for being paid informants to arrest a cop.
$200,000.
$200,000. Hey, you want to go rat out that cop for breaking law? You're in for a good $200,000.
Wow.
Yeah.
Huh. What's up, Lenny?
The pause refreshes.
I'm just waiting to be.
Called upon.
Stimulated. I'm waiting for hear some news stories. That
you want to be stimulated? That's another show. That's later.
That's another podcast. That's go on a podcast for that.
I could do a podcast.
That's technically that. After the podcast.
That's the after podcast.
Yeah.
I think I got to have a laugh here.
We could do a whole other podcast with the crap we talk about during the break. We could, you know. We really could. But let's not.
Yeah, there's some interesting side topics, no question. Well, either way, what are we talking about? You said there's some news stories. What else?
Oh, I'm reading a news story right now.
Okay, well, here's one. As of tomorrow, yeah. Mandatory alcohol tests for driving, like the ride program, and if they even... They've been giving carte blanche, and if they even suspect that you've been sniffing a beer cap, they can ask you to do a breathalyzer. And there's nothing you can do about it, and it's an instant suspension if you don't. It says here, as of tomorrow...
Why did I sit in the passenger seat?
As of tomorrow, those drivers or any driver busted under any circumstances that have to do with, you know, being impaired... They face a mandatory minimum fine of $2,000 and up to 10 years in prison. If there's any accidents, they'll be charged with murder or manslaughter or property damage or whatever, you know. And it takes effect on the 18th of December.
Is this nationwide?
Canada-wide. And if you're asked, you have to.
I kind of assume we did.
Now, what I'm reading here, this is in blog TO. I posted it in our thing if you want to look at it.
Yeah, yeah, I saw you did. I didn't read. Sometimes I don't read things. I figured it would just tell me about it. It saves me time.
Yeah, that, I do that with Marcella a lot.
It's not any different at work either.
Yeah.
Just give me the condensed version by sound, and then I'll read it later, which means it goes to the trash pile.
Now, and they don't need a reason. They just need a whiff, and even a whiff, the smell is not a good enough reason, I guess. I don't know. There, you have to be suspected of being impaired. Now, if you... pull up to a ride smelling like weed, just like you smell like booze, you're going to get breathalyzed. But this...
For alcohol or weed?
This article is not talking about cannabis. It's talking about alcohol, so...
Yeah, that's why I'm saying I'm a little confused. And I didn't think you could refuse a breathalyzer now.
You can't. Well,
but I thought you were automatically guilty if you did.
Since the change, you either comply or it's an automatic roadside suspension and a tow of your car, and then you deal with it in the courts. That, from what I understand.
Either way, it's going to be friggin' expensive. Because either way, they're going to tow your car. Unless you blow and pass.
Yeah, I think we need to have Jack on the show soon again.
Yeah.
too, because now you got me all freaked out.
Me too, dude. And you know, this week is a really...
Hey, Darcy, are you freaked out?
No, folks, I don't drink.
Yeah, besides that, it doesn't matter when you're the passenger.
I'm still
well, that's true too.
I'm still perplexed over what my actual rights are. It's not that I practice the art of drinking and driving. It's not what
obviously we know that, Lenny,
but, come on. You know, your drives from home with the beer in the plastic container that you have. You know, they have to stop, buddy. I'm sorry.
No, you can get wrappers for your
can. No more Jameson.
Stick a Coke wrapper on it.
Pull a trailer park, boys. Just a glass of ice and some rum and Coke and go.
What? You know what? Did I ever tell you that was how I got into that show?
What? Could by drinking and driving?
No. I was not. I'll pretend I was not the first. Like, Trailer Park Boys is the greatest show ever. I heard about it when it was first out. Took me a few years. I happened to see it on Showcase one night, and it was the episode where they're being chased by the Halifax, or not Halifax, I shouldn't say Halifax, but the police helicopter.
Yeah.
And when they rolled the vehicle, and you see Julian walking out with his rum and Coke still fucking full,
mm-hmm.
after the vehicle turned over and crashed, and it's still full, I said, that is brilliant fucking writing right there.
I was living in BC.
That was what got me into that show.
Yeah, I was living in BC, and I'd never even heard of the Trailer Park Boys. And my brother asked me if I was watching it one night. We were talking, and I said, no. I said, I don't even know what it is. He said, just Google it and watch an episode. I got so friggin' homesick because I grew up with those people. Not those people, but...
Oh, here we go, those people again. Jesus.
Those people around the trailer parks. Those people. My peoples.
Your peoples, the trailer park people. You know, I've never watched a full episode. The Bubbles commercial thingy that we have is actually a friend of mine, Barry Mack, who is works on a station somewhere in I don't know where now. But Mary Jane went and did an interview out at Legacy 420 with I can't remember who with Randy, and we've got that. I should play it one day. I'll find it and we'll play it next week.
No, but I remember hearing the show and the first time I saw Quick F this, F that, and like I just thought it was over the top and stupid. But when I saw that guy come out of that vehicle flipped over with this full drink of rum and ice, I said, that's fucking awesome.
Me and my brother decided one night that we were gonna binge watch the entire season of Trailer Park Boys, but we were going to turn it into a drinking game.
Oh, geez.
So I think you had to take a drink every time somebody drink a beer every time somebody said fuck. If Bubble said something really rude, then we had to take a shot of rum and chase it with a beer or a shot of rye or whatever we were drinking. And we made it halfway through the Christmas episode. We had to keep stopping it so we could catch up on the drinking.
It's not my kind of show.
Their Christmas episodes are really good.
They are. They're hilarious. But don't use that for a drinking game because you don't get to watch the whole friggin' show.
I believe that Amy's got new episodes of whatever she's doing with them now.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Cool.
She's always
Swearnet?
Like, yeah, Swearnet. Yeah, that's who it is there. Yeah.
Hey, Mark.
Hey, Darcy.
I see that Thailand is allowing every citizen to grow six plants now and then sell it back to the government.
I think that was last week, Darcy.
Yeah, we were talking about that last week. Where were you? Like old news. Old news, dude.
Darcy was sick last week, remember?
People are sitting back listening tonight saying, they talked about that last week.
But that,
well, I can't help that I was sick.
And that confirms that he didn't listen to the show last week.
No, not.
I don't listen to myself back. I don't.
But you were on the show. You could have been listening while we were on the show.
There you go. Caught you.
No, I was asleep.
Caught you.
That would have been to do was listen.
We caught you.
I was sleeping with the radio on underneath my pillow. So it could have been listening. Yes, you're right.
Yeah, see? Then you would have heard how much we talked about you, too.
Now I'm going to have to go back and listen. You got me all paranoid, Marcel.
Good. The way it should be. You should always be paranoid and afraid.
Here's a, so I was reading some more of these questions on here, Marcel, on that indoor-outdoor gardeners thing there this afternoon. Gardeners thing. Remember on the I made you join it?
Oh, yeah. 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 Yeah, that's like some great comic relief. Thanks for that.
It is. One question. Buddy has a question here. He says, my country is pretty hot, like around 30 degrees Celsius or around 90 Fahrenheit. Can I bring this plant out to the sunlight to save electrical bill?
Obviously, you're living somewhere in an equatorial region.
That's so funny. Yeah, why would you be growing indoors if you live in a country where it's 30-some degrees?
Oh. Oh, some of these... It's actually a really great group to laugh at some of the answers that people give, too.
Oh, my God. Yeah. They're quite funny.
We should throw some of these questions to the internet and let them answer it.
Yes, let's do that. Come on in the chat room at 420radio.ca or give us a call on Skype, Lifestyle Radio.
Dropped my plant trying to move it and repotted it.
I thought you were going to say you dropped your penis, but...
Will it still die? It's a photo. It ripped the roots. Well, every time you repot, you're ripping roots. So that would be fine.
Where'd you get this question?
Dropped it. Did you drop it and break the stalk in half or something? He'll live.
Where'd you get the question?
Off this group. It's an awesome group. There's tons of grow information, but the problem is there's people from all over the world. So somebody will ask a grow question on how would you do this or do that, and somebody will answer from the other side of the world in a different hemisphere. And they have completely different ideas. Hmm. Yeah.
Oh, do they ever?
Yeah, some people would really screw up their gardens if listening to some of these people.
These people.
Oh, yeah.
These people. See, I didn't call them you people.
You're going to get us in trouble, Marcel. We talked about this last week, buddy.
Yeah.
I'm glad it's you, not me.
Oh, well, let's just go a little bit further and say how disgusted I am with our world becoming a snowflake factory.
I can agree with you on that one.
Because it's getting friggin'... Wait, now I can't even use that word. It's getting really stupid. I was probably not allowed to use that word.
What word were you
either,
thinking
so.
Of using before you said stupid? I'm just curious.
Retarded.
Oh, no, don't use that
word. That's like using the word cripple or so.
That was
and I can use that word, but I'm allowed to use that word, though.
Right, but Drew isn't. Because Drew, no, it was, yeah, it was Drew.
Hey, where is Drew?
Cripples.
He's not in our chat room.
Drew is at trampoline night.
And where's Dale?
He's on a trampoline bouncing his ass off.
With Drew?
Yeah. Actually, Drew should YouTube that shit. Drew on the trampoline. No. He's busy. It's his last night of trampolining.
Why? Is there a trampoline competition he's working out for?
No, his son is basically becoming a competitive skier.
Oh, cool. So he's training.
And part of his training is to go bounce his ass off on the trampoline, which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
Yep. And try to do crazy tricks and stuff.
Yeah, and land on your feet.
So, hey, Lenny.
Yes.
Radio Gaga, all right with you?
What's your favorite Queen song, Lenny? Wait a sec, and I can answer that.
You know what? It changes all the time.
Yeah, mine too. So I've loaded Radio Gaga, and then later we're gonna listen to Fat Bottom Girls because I like Fat Bottom Girls.
Every once in a while, like right now in my head, the song I like is Don't Stop Me Now.
I'll say Don't Stop Me Now. We listened to it when Lenny was hurt at work harvesting hemp.
I don't hemp harvester. Yeah. Are you a hemp harvester? I don't know that. I don't have that song. Sorry.
It's okay. There's not too many Queen songs I don't like.
You have to give me these suggestions like hours before so I can get them, not while we're in the middle.
Well, I can tell you right now, next week's Ramones week. So
next week will be Ramones. All Ramones. And Lenny's going to choose which three Ramones songs he wants to listen to.
Well, it is the Ramones. They only get at least six.
We could play Ramones in the background. Sure. Choose six, and then we'll talk.
They are like a minute each.
Yeah. The music has changed so much. Just made me think of that.
Not to me, because I don't listen to any. I listen to the same shit I've listened to the last 40 years.
I
hasn't changed at all.
I prefer classic rock as well, but I mean, I grew up listening to everything, so you know, I don't mind. And my last name is Rap, so I kind of have to like that. But there's some new bands around that have that old classic rock sound.
Greta Van Fleet.
Thank you.
I don't like them.
I don't mind them. You know,
I find they sound too exactly like Led Zeppelin.
And you know,
they're too close.
I watched an interview with Robert Plant, and he was talking about them, and he said that he met them, and they said that they were patterning themselves after Aerosmith, not Led Zeppelin. But everybody compares them to Led Zeppelin because they've got that.
Well, it's the lead singer got that voice.
Yeah.
It's the voice, but the music's very... There's no question they are a modern day...
It's also the clothes. I mean, look at what...
Look at what
Black Crowes did back in the 90s. Same kind of thing. They were the new big band with the voice. Chris Robinson's got an amazing voice. They sing about pot. They sing about partying. They sing about the rocker lifestyle, blah, 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 blah. You know, so there's going to be... Others, right? The Arkells. I like the Arkells. Of course, the Headstones. I've grown up listening to.
Yeah, they're not new.
The Arkells are. They've been around for 4 or 5 years. They're out of Hamilton, right? So, but no, the Headstones have been around as long as I can remember.
I actually shouldn't shit on something. Like, actually, in the East Coast, there's some really good young new rock bands. I just don't listen to them. But
so
they have some good stuff.
Let's make a little bit of a task then, and why don't you find some and we'll play them? I love independent bands. I don't care what the fucking genre it is. Whatever genre you like, if you have music.
I'm having a communication issue. I can hear you.
You can't hear me?
It's in and out.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Maybe it's just me.
It's you.
Maybe. I don't know.
No, because I can hear everybody just fine.
I hear you both, so.
Me as well. I hear you. So, Len, I think that you need to go to your pharmacy and get something for that. And we'll be right back. We're going to listen to some Queen Radio Gaga. This is the 420 Radio Show. We are live here at 420radio.ca. We'll be back in a pimento.
Hey, this is Chi-Chi.
This is Chong.
And you're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
What is it?
Lifestyle Radio. Say it one more time.
420 Radio?
Ooh.
You're listening to the randomness that is 420radio.ca. Sorry, that's 420radio.ca. Powered by ADHD and fueled by cannabis.
Sweet.
are back. This is the 420 Radio Show. We are live at 420radio.ca.
Breaking up on me bad. Fuck.
Breaking up on you bad. Would you want to hear the song now, buddy? Here, we'll listen to the song together. Not allowed to do that.
Darcy's there. You're not missing anything.
All right.
Thanks. Thanks, Marcel.
Marcel, are you drinking tonight?
I've had half a beer.
Oh, God. Can't take you anywhere.
Half a beer. I don't even know if I'm going to finish the other half yet.
Yeah, I don't even finish a full beer anymore. So, we were talking about something on the break, and we said to wait until we got back to talk about it.
Okay.
It was about the song that is being pulled from stations.
Oh.
Yeah.
Do you hear what I hear?
Okay, so I don't know anything about it. So is this the yearly, we're going to pull this? Because I remember about 10 years ago.
This one's being pulled because it's offensive to schizophrenics.
Why? What is it? What's the line that's so offensive?
Do you hear what I hear? Duh. So the joke is way, Al, the joke is way funnier when you don't have to fucking explain it. Although I'm pretty sure people are listening or having a laugh.
Snowflakes there.
Who's on second?
Now. Yeah, the snowflake being offended.
Do you hear what? But do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear? Yeah, you want to hear what I hear? I'll tell you what I hear.
Oh, jeez.
I'm one of them.
You people.
I'm one of them. You people. I am. Yes. I openly am. Yes. I'm openly mental health issues.
Very pro mental health.
Pro mental health. Yes, I am. I'm very pro. Much. I have ADHD. I'm a professional. Anyways, so what was the song last year?
Baby, It's Cold Outside. Was it last year that was an issue?
And what was that? Was that because somebody left their baby in the car in the winter?
No, it's kind of about date rape. If you really listen to the lyrics, I can't.
Oh, Jesus fucking Christ. Come on. Oops, sorry. I'm not supposed to say that.
Now, again, it's innuendo. It's what you make it. It's the dirty mind that reads into the lyrics, people.
Speaking of innuendos, we have a lady, Kristen, is that her name? I think. From Endometriosis and Me. She's been on the show before.
Yep.
And she's going to be here next week, so I thought I'd tell everybody that. And Rose's sneezing.
Where's Steven?
Sleeping. Shh, don't say anything.
If you don't look at him,
he won't come over.
Well, I can't look at him, so...
I'm going to turn the webcam on.
And I'll go, Steven, fuck off, Steven.
You know what? One of the guys that I work with at the now defunct lounge, Steve, every time I talk to him now, I'm like, hey, fuck off, Steven. Come here.
Fuck off, Steven. Come here.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah,
if he only knew the whole story behind.
No, he does. That's why it's so funny. Awesome. Yeah, he's listened to the show before, so he's heard it. Yeah, he knows all about the fuck off, Steven. He's being a good boy, and so is Rose. And the lounge is done, and I came home with a few things from the lounge, so I'm gonna Gungeonista up my apartment.
Nice.
Yeah. And then I'll just sit here alone like I did like I did many days at the lounge.
So it's not going to be any different.
No, no different at all. I just have I can scratch my balls in my living room. That's the only difference. Come on, that was funny. Somebody's laughing. Come on.
I was laughing on the inside.
I was kind of feeling sad for you there for a second when you said, "And I'll sit home alone."
Well, you know, I do have a view of Eglinton and Victoria Park, so.
What about Squirrel Du Soleil?
I could turn the camera on and you can watch now, because I have the camera facing Squirrel Du Soleil.
Nice.
Yeah.
They should be collecting lots of food right now.
Dude, like it's they go right up to the fucking top and then and then they catch it in midair. I mean it's like I wish I was that agile.
Yes, they do. Yeah. And then but here's
I got a buddy who used to do that kind of stuff and he's not here anymore though.
Your little fact of the day. They only remember 20% of the nuts that they bury. No, 10% of the nuts they bury.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
I enjoy watching squirrels. They're like the outdoor cat.
No, the greatest thing is about that quote you just told me there, that fact, Darcy.
Yes.
That somewhere down the line, someone got a fucking federal grant to study that fucking
yeah. Fact. Let's squirrel. SQ something, something, something.
Somebody wrote a submission, got a federal grant.
I'm gonna
paid to do that fucking project.
Okay,
hey, here's a nice fact for you. Every drug that has been recalled by the FDA was first proven to be safe and effective by the FDA.
Oh, is this a segue into where I think you're going?
No, I'm not gonna do it.
I'll do it.
Come on.
They're jumping into the investigations of CBD.
Of course they are. It causes liver damage. I saw it on the internet.
Also, now it sounds like Health Canada is going to try and jump in and stop this kratom thing.
Of course they should. It's dangerous, toxic chemical.
It is. I know. I have some in my cupboard.
Yeah.
I have mushrooms, too.
Yeah, and I think eventually you'll see them do the same thing with Shaga. So they'll basically go out and... Oh, actually, they're doing that already. It's called Roundup. Because they're getting rid of the forests anyways.
Back to the CBD. Any comment? Any theory?
I think it's stupid.
I have several theories.
I like to hear yours, and I'll tell you what mine.
One is they're comparing distillate with a whole plant extract, so it's two different things. Perfect. The other one is the bell curve due to CBD distillate that doesn't exist with a whole plant extract makes all testing results skewed.
I'll agree with that one a little bit too. Yeah. Any other theories?
The other theory is, what are they using for carriers?
That's fine.
Actually, anyway, I can answer that, but keep going. What else? Any other theories? I haven't figured out, by the way.
Do you?
Yeah.
What, for the liver damage?
Yeah.
Oh, what's the liver damage from?
Well, if you actually look at the original study, it was for the Epidiolex,
yeah, which
is the U.S. product in the States. It was the New England Journal of Medicine was the first report of this. Anyway, there was 12 cases. Now, these are serious issues with children, very, very severe epileptic disease. And during the study, they were using massive, massive doses of these products. And there was 12 reports of some increases of liver enzyme increase. But here's what everyone's forgetting. And this is where no one's putting the correlation. The statement from the FDA is fucking bullshit. All these patients were on a drug called valproic acid, which is metabolized by the liver.
Yep.
It is not even a denial that CBD isolate or whole plant affects your cytochrome P450, which I don't care if people don't know what that is, but it's a liver enzyme for for breaking down drugs. So by giving these massive doses of CBD, most likely what, and it may not be the exact reason, but if they're on valproic acid, you are elevating the extreme levels of valproic acid, which can cause hepatotoxicity. So when they're making these giant claims, these patients who are using these drugs of CBD were also on some other potential hepatotoxic drugs. And by the way, the only other study models that have been doing it, have shown any of this, are mice models. And you know what they, you know what the fucking dose that they were using in this mice model that is equivalent to humans? What? 20 milligrams of CBD per kilogram, meaning that a person like myself would be taking 2,000 milligrams of CBD.
Yes.
So don't put out big fucking scary news articles that CBD causes hepatotoxicity. Guess what? If I am taking 2,000 milligrams of CBD, it could happen. Just saying. It might. And if I was also on some other epileptic pharmaceuticals, it could happen a little bit quicker.
Yes.
So just put things in perspective, people.
Yeah.
I hate those shock titles. Fuck, they piss me off.
How come we never see one that the FDA says eating cancer or sugar may increase your risk of cancer?
Oh, God.
Yeah, guess what? Me drinking a bottle of Captain Morgan, my liver enzymes are going up.
Yeah, that too.
The government wants a diabetic society.
No, listen, anyway, I just hate shock. Everyone's freaked out about friggin' CBD.
Yeah, I know. What people don't get is that you need to fucking do some research before you start just, oh, really? Huh, all right.
For the FDA to release that warning like that, that was shameful.
Oh, yes. That's typical of the response that you get when it comes to anything to do with cannabis from the FDA or even from Health Canada. I mean, Health Canada, bless their hearts, want to make sure everybody's safe and protected. Yeah. But
and by the way, in the mice model,
are they doing it?
It was a hexane extract.
Yeah. Yeah, which means that it was a distillate.
You don't even know if it was a pure, there could be even some hexane left in on that product, right?
So, yeah.
but it also remind me and remind as a, I always thought cannabis included medical product available in your pharmacy. Doctor, maybe even if it is over the counter, but you should be monitored by a healthcare professional if you're going to take massive fucking doses of anything.
Right.
So why are we making this so complicated?
Who was it? It was Paul Hornby, wasn't it? That said that a typical dose of CBD should be 300 milligrams.
Yes.
Of CBD.
Yes, Marcel, you're
per
right.
Day?
That also depends on your treatment.
Exactly.
Is that but per day, Marcel?
Pardon me?
Per day or just per dose?
Per dose. Okay. Your typical dose should be 300 milligrams of CBD. He said that on our show, Al.
Yeah. But that's also, is that pure CBD isolate or is that a whole plant extract?
I'm assuming that's likely an isolate.
No, not from him. It would be a whole plant extract.
It also, again, depends what you're treating. Because I know for a fact people using CBD for a little bit of mild arthritis, they do not need 300 milligrams of CBD.
Don't think anybody needs that high a dose. I've proven on myself you don't need that high a dose in THC. So, right?
But I also get, if there's a severe epileptic patient that needs to push that dosing, guess what? Let's monitor their liver because we're going really, really high, and I'm okay with that.
Right. But see, I think what people don't understand is they all assume that more is better when more is actually a waste because your body's only going to utilize what it can at that present time.
When people ask me how much is enough, when you're poop smells
like... You keep cutting out. I can't hear you.
Well, everybody's cutting out tonight, it sounds like. Can you hear me now?
Everybody else hear Al?
I can hear Al now.
I can hear Al.
Yeah?
So all right, let's try it again, Al.
So when somebody asks me how much is enough cannabis to ingest, I tell them if your poop smells like cannabis, then your tank is full.
Your tank is full.
Yeah, I would say if your poop smells like cannabis, your tank is way over full.
You think so?
Yes.
Yes.
Definitely.
What if your pee smells...
Maybe I've had one or too many cookies, maybe. I don't know.
I would rephrase the question of the person. What is your goal from using that cannabis?
Yes. Okay.
What is your outcome? What are you searching for?
So let's go.
How much can you afford?
And what would a dose be for a specific person? You can't tell them because everybody's different, right?
And it's a matter of... how's the best way to put this without everybody getting freaked out? I like working with first-time users more than anybody else in the world. And the reason being is they don't know what high is. And if they don't know what high is, I don't let them find out.
New people. So, new people.
Yes.
Yeah.
New users, I can get them fully medicated and they'll never be high. Right? And we can find the dose that works for them and they won't get high.
And most of the time,
the problem is if you have somebody that already uses cannabis, that's what they're looking for is the high.
Yeah.
And when it stables out to the point where they're not getting the high, but they still have the relief, they don't recognize relief. They want the high.
Yeah, they increase the dose. And they think it's shitty weed. And they increase the dose because they think it's shitty weed. I'll just smoke more.
Right, because they're chasing the high, not the relief.
That's right. Yeah. I like the high. Because it gives me the relief.
Right. No, it doesn't.
For me, it does.
No, it gets you high.
No, it gives me the release. It slows everything in my head down. It, you know, in my case.
In your case. Oh, for your mental health purposes.
Yes.
Mental health purposes, yes, there is a time and place for maybe a little bit of extra THC.
I just like a little tender loving care too, you know. So,
right, but the high is the hardest one because it's the most expensive if you're chasing the high.
Yeah.
Because once you metabolize and get used to that strain or strength of dosage that you have,
okay,
you no longer get high. Your only choice is to increase the dose.
So we've had this conversation long time ago because when I was living up north, I had very little cannabis. And it was like going on a fucking roller coaster because I'd have a nice amount, so I'd be all right, and then I'd have nothing, and then I'd have a nice, you know what I mean? And it's like a roller coaster because you literally, when you're medicating with cannabis, you want to get past that high. Okay? You want to get past the high and go right to the relief, right?
Right.
And sometimes it takes a grand amount. It depends on your ailment. What was the highest that you've ever had a license for, Marcel? Well, no, let me ask a different question. What's the most cannabis that you have had to use? And I'll ask Darcy the same thing after.
50 grams a day.
That's the most you've ever had to use?
Yeah. And actually, it wasn't working.
Because it was so too much.
No, because it was early on and when I was really sick, so I wasn't getting relief because it was the MS was starting to attack my internal organs. So I started increasing the oil, but not really thinking about it until it dawned on me that if I'm not eating, I'm not putting any fat into my system. There's not very much fat for cannabinoids attached to. So, and that's when I started mixing it with a carrier. Got really, really high. So I ended up cutting back from the 5 grams of oil a day.
See, when I asked my doctor if he would sign my license, he said no, because I don't know enough about dosing, but he sent me down to Com, which unfortunately is not around anymore. And that's where I met everybody down there, Tracy and Amy and Neve and Sandra and even Sarah Sunday. And things are a lot different now.
Yeah. It's the doctors still don't know dosing.
No, they don't. I mean, he,
the LPs, majority of the LPs don't know dosing.
You know what? But I do know a few people that work for the legal stores, and they are slowly but surely in introducing the medical question and answer period.
Are they?
They're
here in Nova Scotia. They're not allowed to talk anything medical. So, okay,
no, but you can have a community outreach worker, and that's how they're doing it, I guess. Right. So that's what I was getting at. I was going to ask you. I guess Lenny, you might know the answer to this. What is the ruling about with LPs and the educational angle? I mean, are they not allowed to? Are you guys at work not allowed to do anything remotely information? Oh,
you as an LP, yes you can.
Okay.
Where I guess we got to discuss at a Nova Scotia liquor store. No, they cannot.
Okay.
There's a difference. But
why?
You can give dose, like in the medical platform of an LP, they can give you some dosing guidelines and suggestions.
But
as long as they understand dosing guidelines and suggestions.
Well, and
there's a few that do.
And the people that I know that are doing that, one specifically for a store in Hamilton, they've had to go through some form of training, and they have to have some kind of, you know, proof that they know what they're talking about before you can send them out. It's like, you know, I think what they're trying to introduce is some kind of a smart card service that you have to take courses now before you can work for these stores and stuff like that. So they, you know,
quite on a legal standpoint, probably unless you're a pharmacist or maybe I don't even know if a nurse can get away with it. You really can't dose a drug.
Well, yeah.
As a health professional, like, as I say, I know it's not the same, but just you can take all the courses you want, but.
No, you're right.
Getting gray.
But I think that what we still need to introduce into these stores, legal or not, is that aspect of the question and answer. Because every time I go into a dispensary of any kind, the first thing out of my mind is I wonder what this is like. Maybe this person can tell me. Have you tried this? No, I'm not allowed to. I'm not allowed to tell you about it. But you go into an illegal dispensary and you get that conversation. What do you think of this? Because the bud tenders in those dispensaries have tried all the product. Hello.
I think they're allowed to comment. Like, I think, again, I have to read it again. I'm not the regulatory
guy. Are they allowed to do reviews of their strains and stuff?
The taste, the aroma, the terpenes, how much THC is in it.
Yep.
I think they're even, maybe I'm wrong, but I think I think they can give a little bit of feedback, like it's popular or very general what they're allowed to say is my understanding. But I don't know. I don't really go to dispensaries, so I really shouldn't comment.
The other way to look at it, though, is when it comes to prescribing,
there's
very few drugs that are enforced prescription.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.
And when I say there's a few drugs that aren't forced prescribed, that would be things like methadone, where they literally have to take it in front of the pharmacist so that the pharmacist knows that they're not taking more or less, yada, yada, yada.
I'll give an inside tip. Only methadone specialized doctors or pharmacists even know how to dose methadone.
Yeah.
or nurses. I keep saying pharmacists and doctors, but nurses as well. But
those prescription dosages are basically they're a suggestion that this would be the what we think is the best for you, but we know you're going to do whatever you want anyway.
It's in actually, want to know the truth? Methadone is a great example of how someone should use cannabis. They start low, they go slow, and they titrate you to effect.
Exactly.
That's what they do.
Yeah.
The biggest issue doctors and pharmacists and probably patients have is, I think in the old school world, everyone wanted to talk full milligrams of total cannabis in the oil. They want to talk about grams per day. It's all that stuff.
Yeah.
Really, we got to start talking a little bit, especially dosing your milligrams of active product. That milligrams of THC. What are you chasing? Like, what are you looking for? And the part that professional.
That's the other issue. Yes, that's a big issue, Lenny.
Nice little 16% this versus a 29% this is not going to be the same product.
No. And the thing is that 29% may be way too much and way too strong, and that 16% is right where it's at.
Yeah.
For example, Durban Poison is like, what, 14-16% at its highest, but smoke a real joint of Durban Poison, man, and you'll get high.
Oh yes.
And as much as people don't like the term sativa indica and they get all righteous, the things that tend to run sativa tend to give you that uplift, and the stuff that tends to run indica tends to give you a little bit of that body stone.
What are they using?
Maybe a little bit better for pain.
What are those other two words that they use? Chemovars?
Chemovar.
And cultivar.
Whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's so many chemicals that get. They'll never fucking figure that out. I don't even believe in that myself.
No.
But I believe in, honestly, trial and error. You've got to try something. Well, you can have a suggestion.
Isn't that all medicine, though?
Yes,
it's trial and error.
And it's patient specific, right? I mean, even with cannabis specifically, it's patient specific because everybody has a different chemical makeup going on in their upstairs, pretty much, right?
Yeah, right. same as a blood pressure patient. If I could give everybody Ramipril, everybody would be on the same fucking drug. But guess what? There's like fucking 15 different things out there.
Wow. And they all work differently.
So. In some ways, that doctors and everyone gets all like, oh, it's too hard to dose. And other ways, it's really, really easy, people.
Start low.
Yeah.
Go slow.
Low, low and slow.
Do it the same way you would do hydromorphone.
Yeah.
Just that the 10 pills of cannabis isn't going to kill them like the 10 hydromorphones. But
you're not going to get necessarily hooked and withdrawal in that week. But. And the other part that messes them up is no one knows how to convert dried flower, like a smoke a joint, versus taking some oil orally. Everyone confuses everybody too.
But it's again two totally different delivery mechanisms.
Exactly.
Right.
And guess what, people? You can use both.
Yeah. And you can use both at the same time because you're still not going to overdose. Or no, let me reword this because they keep redefining the word overdose because I prefer overconsumption more than overdose because overdose would lead you to believe that you're going to have adverse reactions and possibly death.
Yeah, you get a bit of a panic attack or you get sedated, whatever.
Yeah, you're either going to fall asleep, you're going to put yourself into a panic attack, but neither one's going to kill you.
I've done the panic attack thing, went for a little ride with the lights and everything.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Well,
black pepper.
Here, I'll give you an example. Here's how I use cannabis. Here's how I do it. For me, this is for me. So I actually like smoking it. I like the taste. That's more of a reckon. That's more of a preference thing. But what I like is I'm a busy guy. I work a lot. Don't want to drink alcohol anymore. Sometimes I get home, I'm a little wired. You know what? Shit, it's 9, 10 o'clock. Fucking, it's getting late. I gotta get up in the morning. want to go to sleep, I'm going to grab a little bit of an indica flower. I'm going to have a few puffs on it, wait about 10 minutes, or a bowl, whatever way you want to do it. And he's like, you know what? I need a little bit more. I'll take another couple puffs. And then I go to sleep, have a good night, get up in the morning. I feel great. If it was a little bit earlier in the evening and I want to get a good sleep, I might actually use some oral drops. But guess what? I'm going to take that around 7, 8 o'clock at night because it's going to take a little bit while to kick in. And it's going to last longer. So you have to know what you're doing, treat yourself, and exactly look what you're looking for. I use, honestly, 10 to 15 milligrams of THC to go to sleep with an oil. Much different than probably a lot of the users on this show. But that's all I need to get to sleep.
I get up every morning, and the first thing I do is light a joint. Yeah. But I have a joint. Then I have maybe another joint. Then I have a capsule that pretty much knocks everybody on their ass.
Yeah.
And then I wake up and I can move and get around and I run my day. And throughout the day, I just smoke joints.
But you're also treating a chronic ailment. I'm treating a little bit of wired brain sleep. Yeah.
I never get high. I won't say I won't get high.
That's not true. There's been a few times over the last couple of years, anyways, that you said I'm actually high.
But I've done that on purpose.
Yes.
Right? But there is a point in the first thing in the morning, usually within 45 minutes to an hour after I take my capsule, that I have about a 45 minute to an hour altered sense of perception. I won't say that I'm high, but it may take me a little longer to respond to a question.
The yeah man stage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, man.
But I've gotten used to that, and I can adapt to it because I go to work every day, and nobody notices it.
Exactly.
Yeah, because everybody else might have medicated. An issue.
Right? But I also don't care.
Trick, and actually you can even use this in opioids. It's functionality, people. If you can't walk or talk or do your job or perform the activity, you've gone too far.
Yeah. That's too much.
Step it back.
Yeah. Cool. It's like functional alcoholics. Functional alcoholics.
I was just going to say that. You know,
until they have too much.
I was just going to say that. Enough. I did not. There's been a few people in my life that I've found out that they were functional alcoholics, and I would not have known, and I've known these people all my fucking life.
Oh yeah.
So
there's all kinds out there.
Yeah. But well, it's just like heroin addicts. You can look at all the people, famous people that have had issues with heroin and other drugs that are just going about their lives.
Sure.
You know? Ray Charles was all his professional life anyways. Was a heroin user.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very public information. But he was a functioning heroin user. And there are a lot. Am I not right?
Yes, plenty of them.
Or am I wrong?
Functioning coke users there are. Just go to court sometime and watch the lawyers.
The issue for a... is when they can't afford...
Yes.
You guys must have a storm going on.
Like, it's sad that anyone's addicted to any chemical, but if a Hollywood actor has unlimited funds and can keep supplying heroin, they're gonna be fine until they get to do it wrong and then they die. But they can perform their duties. Look at Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
but he performed for years, then unfortunately went overboard, and then it's too late. But he was an addict. I actually, documentary, remember when his hair caught fire?
Yeah,
when it was freebasing.
Yeah, that's when he got hooked on pills.
Yeah. Yeah, well,
he wasn't freebasing. That was a Pepsi commercial.
Did you say freebasing? It was a Pepsi. What, you don't
think it was Pepsi freebasing?
You think it was freebasing?
Yeah,
oh, he was freebasing. Oh, Michael. This is 1985, Michael, before the trouble.
No, not Michael.
Is this before he turned white?
Yeah. No.
All right. I remember, next subject.
I remember when he wasn't a white kid.
But he was a functional drug addict because he had unlimited funds. Unfortunately, his doctor fucked up and went crazy on him.
Yeah.
But people didn't know he was a drug addict.
No. No, but there's so many people out there that are drug addicts that don't realize that they're drug addicts.
And again, he was because of the prescription
medications.
Not... All right, yes. here's another instance. We've had Peter Ferencz on the show a few times over the years, and he is known as Dr. Crackhead. He is a crack user. He won't say if he still uses or he doesn't, but he's also a clinical scientist at CAMH. He studies
drugs,
yeah. Well, more addiction. He's an addiction specialist, is what he is. And I mean, but he'll openly tell you, oh yeah, he used to sit there and suck on a pipe, and you know, blah 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 blah. But yet he's
again, who would be the better specialist to talk to? One that's already survived the addiction,
look,
or one that read it from a book.
Look at all the famous people, famous scientist people, Albert Einstein, people like that, that were heavy into drugs.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
But you look at, what's his name? The astrophysicist guy who's passed now, used to have his own show.
The astrophysicist guy.
Yeah.
Well, that gives me a lot to work on.
No, I'll remember its name. But
the guy
along
in the wheelchair?
Same lines. Who?
The guy, was he in a wheelchair?
No.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, you know.
Stephen Hawking?
You know Hawking's is doing drugs.
Yeah.
Not enough of them, but a lot of them use drugs for the same reason that a lot of us use drugs. And that's that. You nailed it earlier, because when you smoke some pot, it clears up your head and you can think.
Oh, it's actually for me, it's just like because my mind races so much. I'm involved in a few different businesses, and yeah. I'm a busy guy, and my brain's always firing at fucking full cylinders. So you know what? Every once in a while, it's nice to turn that fucker off.
That's right.
So that's
where I have to. I
down and focus.
I wake up in the morning and my head just starts spinning. And it's not just what do I have to do today. It's conversations I've had 20 years ago with people.
Yeah.
You know, and I can't shut it off. The only thing that there's only two things that shut it off. Sleep and cannabis. And that's
the first one? Because you cut out on the first one.
Oh, sleep.
Sleep and cannabis, yeah.
Because, and I can tell you this from trial and error, because I am a Ritalin baby. I was on Ritalin from the age of 5 to 16.
I wonder if you're blocking out to anybody else out there.
No, you guys are jumping off just now and then, too. I think it's actually Skype. So. You guys are breaking up, too, Captain.
I don't know. I haven't been breaking up. I've been hearing myself perfectly.
Yeah, I hear myself. So,
I thought we were going for.
I think
Al was like giving us a heartfelt speech, and Marcel just cut him off.
Yeah, he does this a lot. We're gonna go to a break now. I'm gonna cut you off too, motherfucker. And we'll be right back.
No, you are breaking up.
Yeah. You guys are in a storm. We'll be right back.
Tug lightly on this boat of mine. Well, my screen has seen some better times. Well, my buddy poked a hole, now my weed falls deep inside. Please tug lightly on this bowl of mine.
The girl of your dreams has got to be in some bar.
Sorry, boys and girls, but this is X-rated. So if you're under 18...
Get out, goddammit!
Get the point. Good.
Enough?
Bend over.
Y'all ready for this?
Get it up.
I can't wait anymore.
I like to watch.
Whatever you desire.
I know you'll like it.
Do it.
We do it all night long.
Oh, you're gonna take me
home tonight. Oh, down beside that red firelight. Oh, you're gonna let it all hang out. Fat bottom girls, you make the rockin' world go round.
Yeah, and the sound that you hear in the background is my sister filling up the dog food bowl.
And the dog doing the happy dance.
Oh, God, she just howls when my sister comes in here. Sometimes I regret Buster ever teaching her how to do that. So, it's now 8:30, and guess what time 8:30 is? It's time for Darcy to have the stage for a little while.
Me on stage?
Yes, sir.
God. Really?
What you going to talk about today?
Well, actually, I was going...
See, now you're cutting out.
I can hear him.
Yeah, no, I'm here. That wasn't good of me, Marcel, I know. No, actually, I was going to, where'd it go? I had a whole article here I was going to discuss because I knew Marcel would get right into it with me and I could have a really good conversation about it. Just give me a second here and I'll find it again.
He got high.
Actually, I ate a square from somebody that you know, a marshmallow chocolate square. And I ate one the other night and I didn't get a goddamn thing off it. I only ate 3/4 of one tonight and holy God, it's kicking my ass.
Don't you love how people have consistent medicine?
No, I don't. So I can understand how somebody who never ate an edible before, you'd have two people and you give them a square from the same batch. One guy could get totally wasted and the other guy could be sitting there twiddling his thumbs saying, what a waste this is. And now I can understand. Now I understand how that happens because, wow.
All right, concert series, buy tickets.
Are you going to get?
I'm looking right now. Would you want to go on a Friday night, a Saturday night, or a Sunday afternoon?
I don't know, Lenny. What do you think?
Were you guys talking about symphony again?
Yeah.
When?
January 24th, 25th, or 26th. It's at the Rebecca Cohen.
I'd always do Sunday afternoon, but B, just don't book me a ticket yet.
Okay. I like the idea of Sunday afternoon myself, but I just want to go and see what the tickets are worth.
No, I'm under the impression I have a couple potential trips in January. I just don't know when yet.
$35 to $80 per ticket.
I like to sit in the back of Rebecca Cohen because you get a better sound.
You don't have a choice because they've got GIMP seating, so.
Oh.
I'm looking to see.
Now, that can't be a friendly word, Darcy.
Oh, I no. Why? I sit there with them.
I know.
You should understand. We get better service when we go flying together, Lenny.
Actually, you do rock on that one. I'll give you that one.
Yeah.
They just wheel you right through security and take you over in the corner and pat you down real quick and you get going.
Worked great for the ball game too. People just kept bringing us beer.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we still had a good seat so we could see over everybody's head when they stood up. Lenny.
Oh, did I keep doing that?
Just once or twice.
All right.
But that's okay.
Till you got my bag. Then I slowed down.
I found it, Marcel. So, if someone plants a seed, and I'm talking, say, a high THC seed, because it's because of the strain. I won't say the name of the strain, but of this high THC strain, and all of a sudden it popped up through the ground, but two sprouts came out of the one seed. Do you keep either one of them? Or do you just or do you pick one or the other, or do you let them both grow?
I let them both grow, and I know other ones will pick off the weaker of the two.
Mm-hmm.
But I like letting them grow just to see what I end up coming up with for a plant, because it might turn out to have some characteristics that I like, and if that's the case, I may actually breed it.
Now, I want to speak for a medical patient who isn't licensed to grow their own, but legally in Canada can grow their own because they're allowed 4 plants.
Right.
Okay.
So you're wondering, is that considered 2 plants or 1?
Exactly.
Technically, it would be considered 1, different than if you topped the plant and branched it out.
It's coming from one root.
It's still coming from one root base. And that double plant thing, and it doesn't happen once. I mean, that has happened, what, once in maybe 500 seeds?
No, I'd say it'd be higher than that.
Yeah, maybe even higher. I've only ever had it happen a couple times.
And what happens when you plant a seed like that, and it tops itself at the third set of leaves on its own.
I know I had one do that a couple of years ago outdoors.
Yeah.
But it's the same thing. It's still only one plant. So if it was a big enough issue with the cops, they would lose, because it would just be a matter of pulling the plant and seeing that it's only got one root stem.
Being cannabis aficionados like we are, another one is, what happens if you do your own clones, but you take 4 or 6 clones and clone them in the one pot or the one rockle cube?
Separate plants, because they're going to each have their own root base.
But are they, though, going to have their own root base?
Of course they are. Are you going to put 4 stems into one rockle cube?
Yeah.
Well, then you're going to have 4 separate plants that are going to have intertwined roots. Those roots aren't going to grow together. Each clone is going to grow its own set of roots to become its own plant. Right? Even having them in the same rockwell cube does not mean that those roots are going to fuse to each other and become one plant.
No.
Right? So as soon as you cut your cutting and you put root hormone on it and you start it to root, that cutting is growing its own individual root set.
Yes.
All right? Having it beside another one isn't going to mean that they join together and become one. And all it means is that those two individual root sets are going to intertwine. You'll have 2 tap roots.
Yes, you would have 4 tap roots.
Well, you're going to have a tap root off of every clone.
Yes, you would.
The same.
Yes.
Right. So, yes to the split seed, no to the clones.
Okay.
Does that make more sense?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I understood it. The reason I was saying it is because you gave
me an idea. Just in case somebody else doesn't understand it, yes.
Well, yes, and you gave me an idea earlier with when you said, maybe I'm going to take some of these questions I see on that thing into the chat room.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's a good question for somebody starting out, and especially with the legalities that we have with that 4-plant minimum.
Mm-hmm.
But...
Are you allowed to have 4 plants plus clones, or 4 clones? I don't
4 think. Plants total.
Yes, that's hard, eh?
Yeah.
So you could have one mother plant. You could have one mother plant and always have three vegetative plants that go into flower.
That would work. Right. That sounds like a good deal.
But you have to wait until you harvest before you cut your other clones.
Right.
Because, well, I don't know how that goes, because I don't know if they they would have rewritten all the cannabis laws.
See, in my head, what it should read is you're allowed to have 4 flowering plants.
Right.
That's how I would have interpreted that law, or should be written.
But somebody like me would have 12 vegetating plants.
Yeah.
Pull out the 4, flower them, pull out another 4, flower them I'm starting.
I think that's fine. Right? That's fine.
The most efficient way to do this is to set up your mother plant, and then do your grow bigger plants, but do them every 3 weeks or every 4 weeks. You harvest them that way. There you always have bud every month. Yeah. You're always harvesting bud, right? Do that perpetual harvest. Get on to doing that, and I think things will be a lot better, and you would never run out of your smoke. I don't think actually you could smoke at all before if you grew it properly before the other plants done.
Grow it properly, you grow your 4 plants and do 4 plants every time. You'd probably have a hard time smoking that entire 4 plants worth.
Well, Marcel, you figure it out at say a half a pound for the average person every month if you're on a perpetual harvest.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't realize that, you know, 4 plants, that's it. That's all. But if you get good at it.
Yeah.
You know.
A lot.
I got 4 in my tent right now, and they're they're getting really big.
And they've removed them. There are no height restrictions or side restrictions, is
no.
there?
Right. So you, if somebody was smart and wanted to spend the time and money, they could build a room to grow four plants and pull 5 pounds per plant. So there's 20 pounds per harvest twice a year.
Even on an average scale, what's an average plant? It's about a pound, right?
No.
Hey?
No, it's not, because it depends on the strain
okay.
that you're growing, because it could be anywhere from 30 grams to 5 pounds, and how long you're vegging, what type of grow you're using.
Yeah,
there's a lot of variables.
Darcy knows a little bit about that, eh?
The average Joe Blow growing New York City dealer is not going to harvest any more than 60 grams a plant, yeah. and that's a good harvest.
60 grams. That's 2 ounces, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Wow, my brain's just working today. Got the math right on.
Right. I mean, that's what I take into consideration. Before I had a perpetual harvest going that I never ran. Then I moved, and then things got all fucked up because I didn't start growing indoors until like 6 months after I got to my new place. And my outdoor crop that year, I did only have one or two plants because I didn't really know the area. And I never lost a bud off them. So then I said, okay, I'm in a good area. And then this year I lose every fucking plant. So I guess I'm not in a good area. So next year, like I said to Marcel, I'm not putting anything outside. Not here anyways.
No. It's not worth it. Don't feed the neighborhood kids.
I'm not. Because I'll end up doing something stupid. And then I value my job way too much.
Or you spend a little bit of money up front. And we build a place to grow, and then all they can do is sit on the outside and drool and cry and whine.
yeah.
Right? And, you know, collect pollen from all the other neighbors that are growing that have no idea what a male looks like.
Are there any studies or anything about what's happened with legalization as far as what's grown and where? Hemp versus cannabis?
And I think that's going to...
There's no studies, but there's a lot of
conjecture.
Bitching. Yeah. There's a lot of bitching for the gorilla growers that are now trying to grow where they always grew for years and years and years, that somebody next door is growing hemp.
Yeah, like I don't understand. We're going to... Nova Scotia's going to have a big outdoor crop down in the valley next year. Another... putting one outside, and they announced it in the newspaper and whatnot this last week. And but here's the thing that gets me is I bet you not 20 kilometers away from where his farm is a huge hemp field.
You know,
it's not just that. He's growing in an area. He's putting that in an area where those people have been growing down there, gorilla growing for years. Those people, but they've been growing for gorilla growing for years down there, because I mean the valley's a fertile place to grow. You don't think they're going to get any cross contamination?
This is what I'm saying.
And
so,
and like Paul was saying last week, they just put up with it down in Jamaica. I mean, pretty much every plant has some seeds in it, at least a little, right? I mean, and I think that's probably what's going to happen here in Canada, probably everywhere.
Oh yeah.
You'll either see that, or you'll see it being made after enough LPs lobby and bitch and moan and go on about it. You'll see because they're outdoor cannabis crops with the independent farmer with his big hemp crop. You'll see them go on that they'll make it mandatory that hemp farmers have to plant a feminized seed, which is not going to solve the situation because.
That won't work because
if an LP wants to grow outside,
it's a huge risk.
Lenny just broke up.
Not saying that he can't make lots of money at doing it, but what happens if you spend all the millions of dollars and get nothing back in return? I mean, that's a big hit, man.
That's your fucking choice, and right. You should be putting that into your fucking factors if that's the way you're going to go.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Because I don't...
There's
I don't,
a reason we all grow indoors, people.
Yep, and we have crazy filtration systems.
Yeah.
So it filters all that pollen out of the air so it doesn't get into your room.
Is there a possibility that that's going to happen, though?
I honestly don't know. I don't know, well, Al.
Anything lots of new can information happen, coming, I guess, eh? What was that, Lenny?
I said anything.
Yeah.
You just try to mitigate it and reduce the risk.
Reduce the risk.
Reduction.
Who's there, Mom?
What'd you say?
Well,
somebody's whispering.
I am. Just one sec. I'll be back in a sec.
What are you wowing about, Marcel?
Oh, it was a really stupid theory that THC and CBD could cure tinnitus. I will tell you firsthand experience of having tinnitus since the 80s that cannabis and THC will not cure tinnitus.
Oh, who needs a cure for tinnitus?
There is no cure for tinnitus.
Actually, I have one.
Oh, really? What is it?
Therapy. Look up what a product. I'm going to recommend a product called Vinpocetine, Vinpo.
Vinpo.
There's a lovely company in Canada, a supplement company called AOR.
Vinpocetine.
And you know what? Yeah. He's allowed to make these suggestions because he's the pharmacist.
And right. It's at the medicine shop on Prince Street in Truro, available right now tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock when I'm there.
There you go. Somebody no, be knocking
wait a
on
second.
The door.
Don't plug myself no. off.
To cut in there, Lenny. Don't come at 9 o'clock. Wait till 10:30.
Yeah, don't say any reason why.
Nope, just don't come till 10. Wait till 10:30.
It's really busy when Lenny's there at 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning.
Yes,
I'll check out WebMD because WebMD never lies to me.
WebMD will not have heard of Vinpo.
Oh, you want to bet?
Yeah.
I'm
can you tell us what it is, please, Lenny?
I'll be impressed if they actually heard of it.
Okay,
so tell us what it is, Lenny.
Oh, here you go. They actually have it, do they?
I'm trying to read it, Al. Shush.
Okay.
Vinpocetine is a man-made chemical. Its structure is similar to a substance found in the periwinkle plant. People use vinpocetine as medicine. It's sold as a prescription drug in Germany under the brand name Caviton, but high-quality studies evaluating its safety or health benefits are lacking. In the U.S., vinpocetine may be included in dietary supplements, but this is controversial. In the 1990s, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration acknowledged vinpocetine as a new dietary ingredient. This allowed it to be included in supplements. But in 2016, the FDA tentatively concluded that vinpocetine might not meet the criteria to be allowed in dietary supplements. They requested comments about this conclusion, yada, yada, yada. Maybe unsafe for women who are pregnant or may become pregnant.
Everything's unsafe for pregnant women.
How does it work? It is not known exactly how vinpocetine works, but it might increase blood flow to the brain and offer some protection for brain cells or neurons against injury. People use vinpocetine for improving memory and thinking skills, boosting energy for weight loss, and many other conditions, but there's no good scientific evidence to support these uses. Vinpocetine. So let's go and look up vinpocetine for tinnitus.
You should get a hit.
That's what I'm looking for.
I'm saying you're going to get 6 million hits, Marcel.
No, I don't know if I ain't going to get that many. You might get two.
I got
Google.
I got 203,000.
Oh, all right, more than I thought.
Vinpocetine is long used in Eastern Europe to treat various forms of hearing disorders. 1986 review of 8 independent studies of substance enhanced blood flow found that vinpocetine produced improvements in hearing as well as in the ringing of ears or tinnitus following trauma to the ear. All right, you got it in stock?
I shouldn't say that I do because there's a asthma movie this week. He may have bought it on you. Oh. I rarely sell it. I keep it because I keep one bottle in stock because every once in a while someone comes in with a ringing in their ear. It's like, this will not go away. Nothing will work. I say, try this. And it does usually help them, and they usually actually go away.
So, but does it go away, or is it something you have to take every day to try and...
It depends on the condition. Most people that I've had use it, it went away, and they stopped it, and were able to, and it just never came back.
I've had it, and it's, well, since the 80s, and it would be due to noise trauma, such as explosions, gunfire, things like that.
Yeah.
What a whiner.
Maybe that's what I got.
As I've told all my patients who use it, it's like, listen, I've had some feedback from some very smart natural medicine physicians in the USA that have had success with it. So I'm sharing the recommendation and reasonably safe opportunity to try it. And they've tried it, and a couple of patients, it made a difference for them. It's the only product I've been able to find that will... you could even attempt to treat tinnitus, so that's why I carry it.
I don't like tendinitis.
Tendinitis? That's a whole other thing.
I know.
Oh, and then this one says that pentoxifylline, lidocaine, and vinpocetine are used as a combination.
Pentoxifylline makes a little sense. Increases blood flow.
But why lidocaine?
I'm not sure about the lidocaine. Why?
Yeah.
Are they injecting? What do they do? How are they putting? How are they applying that? They're not taking that orally.
I'm not sure. It's a PDF. I don't want to open it.
Okay.
Only because it'll take me a long time to read the PDF.
It could be a little topical drop, is what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Well, there's another product, Lenny, that me and Marcel got to try that. I actually tried a little bit of them, and they were pretty cool. But I gave them to somebody that was sick, and they dropped the Pop Rocks.
Oh, the Pop Rocks. Another lovely... AOR should start paying us a little fucking fee every year this soon.
Yes, I think so. We do a lot of advertising for AOR here.
AOR is one of... they are one of my favorite supplement companies in Canada as a pharmacist. So.
Al?
Yeah?
Are you familiar with Pop Rocks?
Oh, yes.
Well, how would you like to have Pop Rocks with an omega-3 for oral health?
Ooh, I'd try that.
Yeah. Well, this is what AOR sells.
It's probiotic.
Yeah, not omega-3. It's a probiotic for oral health.
I'd try that.
And they work amazing for someone if you're starting to get a cold and got a scratchy throat. That's who I gave them to. And he took them for 2 days. And the two packages, and his throat was completely fine on the third day.
I still have a package. I'm waiting for a sore throat.
Yeah, I'm seriously trying.
Can you send me some?
I just eat this candy once in a while.
What are they called?
Because they are tasty too.
What are they called?
They're actually called Lava Rocks.
Yeah, Lava Rocks.
Okay.
But if we all remember those candies you put in your mouth, the Pop Rocks, and they all pop and dance.
Same thing.
Same thing.
Same thing.
Tastes exactly the same.
Yeah, they do.
It goes right against Health Canada standards by making medicine appealing to kids.
Huh.
Because it's a probiotic, I believe it's actually a medicine based on Health Canada standards.
Read the back of the package and look at the age group. It says 6 to 12, one package per day, 12 to 18 or 12 to whatever. It says don't exceed 3 packages a day or something.
Hillary is asked, does it help with spinal stenosis and TMJ-induced tendinitis?
Tinnitus.
That's a Lenny question.
Lenny, you've got them.
Yeah.
The professional answer, it's hard because I don't know what other medications you're taking, so it's hard for me to legally make that assessment. But B, you will not find a study that says it works for it. So if you can look at your medication list and conclude that there's very unlikely of a risk of an adverse effect or drug interaction. It's something you almost have to try and see, unfortunately.
And this has been our new segment, Ask the Pharmacist.
That is my professional answer.
Does spinal stenosis? No. Not going to help with spinal.
But that's if those conditions are causing a tinnitus, try it.
Now Marcel is breaking up because he's surfing as well.
No, I'm not. I'm in the chat room. The TMJ-induced tinnitus, yeah, I could see it. Maybe if it helps with tinnitus, it could help with
that. What is TMJ?
Transmandibular jaw, something like it. Yeah.
Oh, is that where you're cracking your jaw all the time?
It's painful.
That. Yeah. I crack my jaw 20 times a day.
The only medication she is on is cannabis.
Yeah. Oh, cannabis would be a good cannabis product, only. As a compounding pharmacist, there's lots of things I would recommend in my pharmacy as topicals, things like that.
Hey, Darcy, yeah. Click it together again. Come on.
What? Actually, a TMJ, this is an over-the-counter thing you can probably find in some health food stores or good pharmacies. It's some magnesium gel. Rub that on there.
Yeah. Ask the pharmacist.
Honestly, you can pretty much...
I think that should be a new...
Any ailment, rub magnesium gel on.
I think we should do a new segment where people ask the pharmacist questions. And get their answers.
Bill or doctor.
Cannabis interfere with my metformin. C5 and C6 stenosis. Yeah, that could be too, causing tinnitus too.
It interfere with my metformin? Cannabis?
Yeah. No, I think that's the kind of questions that we'll start getting.
Having metformin helped me offset the amounts I needed to use. And then when I didn't have, I had a crutch, but it made me fucking angry all the time, so I won't use it again.
Metformin made you angry?
I'm sorry. I'm on metformin for my diabetes.
Yeah, that's a diabetic drug.
Yeah. Duh.
But metformin is now being studied as an anti-aging drug.
Yes,
it is actually an anti-aging drug.
Could that be why my hair is growing back?
The metformin causes, it is an excellent drug.
You know what? I go through this every morning. I wake up, I go poop, I have my breakfast, I have my metformin, and then I feel shitty about 2 hours, and then it goes away.
That's your metformin.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not morning sickness.
There's a pathway in the body. There's a pathway in the body called the AMPK pathway, and if you activate that, you're gonna live longer. And that's what metformin does. And I'm not. It's fucking complicated, but metformin does rock. There's some drugs out there that are really good. That's a good one.
What are the so diabetes and then anti-aging and now it. I mean, my hair started growing back since I started taking it, to be honest with you.
Cool.
Slowly.
Well, getting your insulin levels a little bit balanced, and the insulin was obviously fucking up some of your other hormones, and that's probably what's going on.
Huh. Cool.
All the hormones play together, people.
Yep.
Now, if I could only remember to take it every day.
Question, probably not going to get a good answer for that one, because probably no one's ever studied it.
Well, we need to.
Can I think of a reason why they couldn't use them together? I can't think of a reason why not.
Well,
put it this way, I can say for a fact, metformin is probably the number top five drugs out there prescribed.
I use metformin and cannabis every day.
Yeah. It's the odds are we would have heard something by now, is all I'm going to say.
Yeah.
So it's one of those drugs that actually has some use, like aspirin.
You broke up there. What was it about aspirin?
Like aspirin. It's a drug that actually has a use. It's not just there to give you a pill.
Metformin, like I say, it was originally for diabetes, but I have a feeling they're discovering that it's way more beneficial than people realize.
And what is metformin? Is it anything natural at all, or is it synthetic?
Oh, no. It's... There's I don't know where they.
You have now. You broke up, so you have to start over again.
It's a pharmaceutical. Not really sure.
And then broke.
Never up went again. That far. It's been metformin.
Been around a long
fucking
time.
Fucking 40 years, 50 years.
There you go. I started looking up metformin, and because I was looking up tinnitus earlier, it came up with metformin and tinnitus, and metformin is a prescription that may actually cause tinnitus.
The risk with metformin and the risk with all drugs, and this is what people, this we can do a big topic on this someday.
Yeah.
It's called drug-induced nutrient deficiencies. So as much as metformin does a lot of good things, it can actually deplete you of certain things like a little bit of coenzyme Q10 and some other stuff. So when they say they cause side effects, it's usually because it's doing something else.
Well, it's like cannabis. Too much cannabis, you're going to deplete your magnesium. Right?
Everything depletes.
What was that?
What?
Everything
magnesium.
What? Oh, okay.
I always joke, just rub magnesium on it.
Is that like Windex?
Yeah. Darcy?
Yes. We had a friend that if you want to use the word overdose, overdosed on metformin.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, he was in the hospital with his kidneys shut down.
Why would you want to overdose on metformin?
He didn't. What happened was he went back to his doctor, and his doctor upped his metformin.
Oh, okay.
At a higher dose than what was needed, I guess, and when he was out rock hounding, and then now you're not going to know who I'm talking about.
Yeah.
He was out on the mud flats and felt really sick, and before he got back to the shore, that's when everything happened, I guess.
Oh, really?
Your kidneys have to work.
Yeah.
Metformin kidney disease is a risk.
Yeah. So I got a question for you, Lenny. What risks is gabapentin to the stomach lining and liver and kidneys? And I'm talking heavy use.
Say it again.
I said, what risk does gabapentin have to the liver's kidney and stomach lining? And I'm talking a heavy user at like 6,400 milligrams a day.
Well, considering the max dose is usually about 3,600 milligrams a day, you're probably at risk of something.
Yeah.
Yes. And you did that for 3.5 years.
It's not
How long ago was this?
13 years ago.
Yeah, I think you're fine now.
It's probably fine now. Again, I'd have to look it up. Obviously, if you look up every drug, I'm sure there's a liver and kidney toxicity at some point. But it is not a common thing or common risk. How about that? And same as the stomach lining.
Good. Makes me feel a little better.
Yeah, I mean, it was 13 years ago.
Yeah, no. Because that's what my dose was for 3 years.
How much? The issue with GABA, 6,400?
6,400 milligrams, yeah.
Yeah, your doctor was just trying to get rid of you.
Yeah.
There was 6,400 milligrams of that, and there was 180 milligrams of baclofen and 360 milligrams of tizanidine.
Holy crap.
Those were the three drugs I was on.
And this was all for pain and spasticity, or?
Yes. And then they had me on ditropan for my bladder, but I realized I didn't need it. So, and then I stopped taking it, and then my bladder just kind of worked itself out. Well, no, it worked itself out. You know, unfortunate than some people, I can still feel my bladders and know when I need to go on the other end.
Right.
So, where most people in chairs after a spinal cord injury can't. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was my dosage. And that's what it was for. I mean, there were lower doses of the same drugs for the first 2 years, but 2 years into it, I think I was just feeding an addiction now that I think about it.
Yeah.
Because I would take my pills and fall asleep, wake up, eat, take my pills, fall asleep.
Here's breaking news, people. Gabapentin's going to be the next opiate epidemic.
Yeah, I think so.
And it packs the weight on you like crazy. holy, I gained like a lot. I didn't eat much, so I gained a lot of weight when I was on that.
Yeah. I was not a fan of it.
And now I just use cannabis.
But I never went up to 6,400. I think I went up to 3,500.
I don't know what all these meds that I hear people talking about are doing, because I've always refused opiades. I mean, I've had T3s. That's about, and I've taken a perk now and then just at a party, but I've not for pain used any opiates. I've just I had Nabilone and cannabis.
You know, so I don't know. I'm the same way. I don't use opiates. I won't use opiates. I've refused every prescription.
But you have, though, in the past, right?
Pharmacy.
I don't mind Nabilone. I don't mind Nabilone.
As a backup, I you know, it's a good idea. As a backup, when you don't have access to enough cannabis to keep you going with just using cannabis, then it is a good backup.
Right, but Nabilone is basically a distillate. It's a synthetic THC, which would be the same as a distillate THC.
Yeah.
So it's very limited in its effects for you.
And
sedating.
I was going to say, like, yeah. I would take one in the morning, and then one in the, you know, my doctor was really good about when I needed it, right? So I probably would only take three a day, but then it got to the point where it wasn't working, so I started putting it under my tongue, right?
Yeah.
And of course, that helped. But I found that it made me very irritable, and I would be asleep after an hour, you know? Like, I wasn't able to do much. I did what I had to do, but the rest of the time I was sleeping. I didn't like really? That. Yep. Didn't like it at all. It basically couch locked me. Knocked me out.
And which is weird because it's just THC.
Yep.
No CBN or CBD.
Pharmaceutical synthetic, it's designed to bind to the receptor strong, so it is
good. Yes, yeah, it is. Actually, I know a breeder, like a cannabis breeder, that he actually likes Nabilone every once in a while, and he says it relaxes them differently than cannabis does. And this guy can breed any strain he wants, but he still would rather reach for an Nabilone once in a while. Teach their own. I don't need them, so I don't bother with them.
I stopped taking them.
But I did try Sativax.
I tried it too myself.
I haven't tried that.
That was the biggest waste of money in the world.
I asked about if I could try it, and my doctor looked at me and said they're only giving that to people with MS, which is bullshit.
No, but that's all it was approved for. Yes. First game, Canada, was MS.
But I was just saying, yeah.
Chemotherapy-induced appetite problems.
Huh.
How did you get it, Darcy?
Through my spinal cord specialist.
Just to try it. Did it help you?
No. It made me feel. It made me feel right lightheaded.
Yeah.
And it was more of a sativa high. And I found it acted my spasticity up even more.
It is a sativa. It's a mostly sativa strain. Because I know the strain that was licensed to them.
Okay.
It's more of a sativa strain, which always made me laugh when they said it was for MS. But I did the math using their calculations to see how strong it was and versus the price. It was basically, each one of those bottles with 50 microsays sprays has the equivalency of 2 grams of dried flower, which means that's $80 a gram for that bud.
It's crazy expensive.
Oh, it's unreal. $160 a bottle, and that was 10, 11 years ago.
It hasn't dropped.
Yeah. See, that's just an outrageous price, you know, for 2 grams.
I find bud. I find a simple, hate me if you will, I don't care, a simple vegetable glycerin tincture works for me wonders. It keeps me going, and it gives me a little zip, and I continue it, and I have it in my tea every morning, and yummy, yummy. I bet a lot of people don't like the vegetable glycerin.
Yeah, I mean, it's everybody's different.
Well, you know what? I like it because I can put it in my my pod, in my Shatterizer pod, and I can vape it. I don't add vegetable, the propylene glycol to it. I find
vaporizing glycerin?
Better than MTC, I would think.
How do you know?
I don't know.
Lenny,
you're creating a vapor that's going into your lungs. It's going to upset the capillaries.
But that's what they use. That's the vegetable glycerin is what's in every e-cigarette.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
Since when?
That's what they use in the e-juice. They use vegetable glycerin with propylene glycol, which I don't use. I just use the vegetable glycerin.
Right. And they also use tocopherols.
Okay, I don't.
Right, there's not been enough studies in vaping to say whether or not vaping vegetable glycerin is harmful or not.
Same with shatter.
What do you mean?
We don't know if vaping shatter a lot is going to affect you.
It could other coat than your the lungs. Fact that we've been smoking hash, which is essentially shatter.
Okay.
Just in a different form for thousands of years.
Fair enough.
And nobody's died.
Fair enough. Right?
But we haven't had people inhaling vapor from propylene glycol or vegetable glycerin for 30 or 40 years, let alone thousands.
Put it this way. In my opinion, I don't use nicotine products at all. If I was to start, and as fucked up as this sounds, I think from a safety perspective, I'd rather smoke the cigarette.
I'm not using anything nicotine related in it. I'm making it myself. All I'm putting it in is bud and vegetable glycerin, and I make a tincture and I use it.
Right. You have no idea what the effects of that vegetable tincture may be having on your lungs.
No, and to be honest with you, for the most part, I'm ingesting it. I don't use the pod.
Keep ingesting it.
Ingesting it is a hell of a lot better than
inhaling. I don't use it in the pod very often, but I have. When it's all you use what you got.
Yeah.
If it's here and there, the probable likelihood of harm is pretty minimal, but it's when you start that chronic use of it.
Well, I don't use it. I'm more apt to stick shatter in my shatterizer, to be honest with you. That's what it's for.
Hey, Al?
Yo.
I watched a documentary on Netflix.
Yes.
It's called Broken.
Broken? Okay.
And watch it. And there's one on there about vaping.
Okay.
You know why most high school kids vape?
Because cheaper, it's not very accessible.
No.
Why?
It's for the buzz.
They get high. You get that nicotine buzz.
Yes, of course. I used to get high off the cigarettes that I smoked. Yep. Sure, that's why I smoked.
Lenny, if you were to take a drag off of a cigarette, you'd be high.
Yes.
I only smoke when I drink. Bullshit. That was me like fucking 20 years ago.
I quit smoking cigarettes 7 years ago.
Yes.
And it's for the buzz.
And yes.
And that's why 9 out of every 10 high school kids use a Juul pod over any other vaping device. It's because Juul has way more nicotine in their little pods than the other all the other ones.
And that's why there's a big lawsuit.
Yes.
Darcy and I were talking about this today. So Juul pods here in Canada, I think it's $20 for 3 pods. And that's the equivalent to 3 packages of cigarettes.
Oh, so I don't need more expensive?
A pack of cigarettes is $15 to $20.
Well, at the corner store, it's $19.85 because my wife smokes, and that's what I pay for them.
Right. So almost $20 for a pack of cigarettes, or you can get three packs into these cute little pods that have literally thousands of flavors. So, of course, the kids are going to migrate to them. One, it's cheaper. Two, they're going to get a buzz every time. And three, they can get whatever flavor they want.
But yet, we can't use cannabis.
No, that's dangerous.
it's a fucked up world now.
Yeah, and on that note, gentlemen, we have
come to the... Yeah, we should go and let these nice people go home.
And I have to walk my dog. She's standing behind me. It's like she knows. She knows how. Yeah.
Baby, it's cold.
I'm saying I'm in Nova Scotia and you're in Toronto. I don't know how cold it is up here.
It is -2 right now.
Well, in Truro, it's -4 with a wind chill of -13 because the winds out there blowing about 70.
We're supposed to get 10 inches. Ten centimeters on Monday.
I've got to get through an alert first because we have a snow squall watch on.
Awesome. My favorite's the snow bomb.
Gentlemen, you guys enjoy your snow.
Here it's -5 and feels like -13. I'm staying in.
This has been another live edition of the 420 Radio Show. We'll be here on Friday with a guest. And now I can't remember who it is.
Endometriosis.
Yes. Kristen?
Yes.
Kristen or Christy? I'm looking. It's underneath my microphone. Christy.
There you go. Yeah.
And you guys, thanks for hanging out and say goodnight now.
Yeah, don't forget to tune in next week's episode of Ask the Pharmacist.
Ask the Pharmacist. Ask the Pharmacist.
Yeah.
It's a whole different
baby
show.
Baby, it's cold outside.
Baby, it's cold outside. Good night, guys.
And right. You hear what I hear.
Yeah.
You're listening to 420radio.ca, Canadian Cannabis Radio.
So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Why not?
I'm trying to get on this lifestyle radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's all right.
You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.